There are countless ways to frighten a person, especially when it comes to horror. Through a slasher, torture porn, supernatural, or even a movie filled to the brim with jump scares, there are endless ways to make an audience squeal. However, nothing is quite as effective as a psychological horror, a movie that digs deep into your psyche and refuses to leave. So today on Top 5 Scary Videos, I'm going to be counting down our list of the top 5 horror movies that messed with your mind. Before we begin though, be sure to stick around until the end of the video where I'll be responding to some of your comments. And with that, let's jump in. Coming in at number 5, we have The Killing of a Sacred Deer. Released in 2017 and directed by Yorgos Lanthimos, The Killing of a Sacred Deer stars Colin Farrell and Nicole Kidman and follows a cardiac surgeon, Colin Farrell, who secretly befriends a teenage boy with a connection to his past. He introduces the boy to his family, who then begin to fall mysteriously ill. Now, director Lanthimos is renowned for making incredibly uncomfortable and distressing movies, entering Killing of the Sacred Deer with Dogtooth and The Lobster under his belt. However, Killing of a Sacred Deer seems to be the most distressing. The relationship formed between Colin Farrell and the teenage boy is wildly uncomfortable and awkward, making you want to shield your eyes away from anything happening on screen. However, before we know it, awkwardness turns into horror, with the teenage boy Steven demanding a sacrifice. The movie digs deep under your skin and plays out in a deadpan and absurd way, just like the rest of his movies do. It descends so quickly into madness that you can't quite keep up, and things are soon the stuff of nightmares. It is almost impossible to describe the effect Killing of a Sacred Deer has on the psyche, but it lingers with no desire to leave. Coming in at number 4, we have Funny Games, directed by Michael Haneke and released in 1997. Funny Games is a psychological Austrian horror movie that revolves around two young men who hold a family hostage and torture them with sadistic games in their vacation home. The movie puts you as the viewer through the ringer, along with the rest of the family. It feels like the director is calling us out for seeking such a disturbing movie, and in turn kidnapping us and taking us along for the ride. The film frequently blurs the lines between fiction and reality, and actively highlights the act of observation, making you, the viewer, feel like the villain. The movie wants to hold you, the viewer, responsible for your taste in violence, and in turn taking us captive along the way. The character Paul frequently breaks the fourth wall throughout, and even addresses the camera in certain scenes. On top of that, Paul frequently states his intentions to follow the standards of film plot development, and shows awareness of the audience's expectations, even asking us questions throughout. It's a movie that is as self-aware as they come. It feels like a reality show that you have the control over. After all, you have the remote, you can end this at any moment, but you don't, and the director knows that you won't. So the characters continue to call you out, while inflicting torture on the innocent family. The movie is truly pure genius, and if you haven't yet, I suggest you check it out immediately. Also, the same director did an American remake, starring Naomi Watts. It's very good, just as good. Coming in at number 3, we need to talk about Kevin. Directed by Lynn Ramsey and released in 2011, We Need to Talk About Kevin is a psychological thriller horror starring Tilda Swinton, a travel writer slash publisher who gives up her freedom and bohemian lifestyle to have a child with her husband. However, pregnancy doesn't seem to agree with her, but what's worse is when she does give birth, it is to a baby boy named Kevin who she just can't seem to bond with. Worse still, when Kevin grows up, he becomes a sociopathic teenager who commits a horrific act. Now, the movie is absolutely haunting and earth-shattering, and it takes on one of the most disturbing and upsetting issues in contemporary America, school shootings. Jumping through time and memory, We Need to Talk About Kevin showcases the relationship between Eva and Kevin, and her unraveling psyche, which begins to turn on itself. From start to finish, the movie is an onslaught of mental torment, as we watch on as Kevin grows into a teenager and the hideous deeds he commits. The film is incredibly tough to swallow, and throughout watching feels like you might be drowning along with the characters. It's a haunting piece of work that you can't quite enjoy, but you can commend for being so visceral and impactful. You never get the answers you seek while watching the movie. Instead, it seems to be actively denying you any kind of resolution, and when the credits roll, you feel completely drained of emotion and tormented by what you just saw. Proceed with caution. I honestly don't think I could watch it again. Once was enough. In at number 2, we have Session 9. I've discussed this movie countless times on this channel now, but I will keep pushing it until the day I die, because this horror movie is pure excellence. Trust. Directed by Brad Anderson and released in 2001, Session 9 is a psychological horror that follows an asbestos abatement crew who begin to experience growing tensions while working in an abandoned mental asylum. This is paralleled by the gradual revelation of a former patient's disturbed past through recorded audio tapes of her regression sessions. Now, Session 9 is an incredibly effective slow burn of a horror movie that seeps under your skin and won't necessarily leave after the credits roll. Now, each one of the crew members have their own dark secrets that begin to unravel the deeper into the asylum they go. When one of the team members members begins to listen to the haunting tapes of a patient who suffered from severe multiple personality disorder, things begin to descend into madness and become increasingly chilling. The asylum is dingy in the movie lo-fi, making everything appear gritty and uncomfortable. The movie is moody and incredibly atmospheric, and instead of focusing on jump scares, focuses on the horrors of the mind. If you have yet to check out Session 9, you certainly should. From start to finish, you are sucked in and isolated inside the asylum with the crew. And not to mention, it has one hell of an ending that makes you question how you didn't see it coming in the first place. And finally, coming in at number 1, we have Jacob's Ladder. Released in 1990 and directed by Adrian Lynn, Jacob's Ladder is a horror film starring Tim Robbins that tells the story of protagonist Jacob, a soldier during the Vietnam War whose experiences prior to and during combat result in strange, fragmentary visions and bizarre hallucinations that continue to haunt him. As his ordeal worsens, Jacob desperately attempts to figure out the truth. Now, this movie is a combination of many things. It is one part war movie, one part political thriller, and another part emotional torment. Throughout the movie, Jacob is trapped in a reoccurring nightmare from the war, as well as struggling with the grief over the death of his young son. He begins to lose his grasp on reality while battling an ongoing suspicion that he may already be in hell. From the director of Fatal Attraction, Jacob's Ladder, from start to finish, has an intense grip on us and our psyche, with us not quite knowing what is real and what isn't. From People with No Faces and Subways with No Exits, what exactly is happening, or is it all merely existing in Jacob's mind? Throughout the movie, he attempts to unravel his traumatic past while also suffering from severe case of dissociation. From start to finish, the movie is a nerve-wracking rollercoaster ride, only you're constantly falling with no end in sight. All Jacob wants is peace, and all we want is to know what the heck is going on. Some interesting information for all you horror lovers out there: it was actually Jacob's Ladder that inspired the horror franchise Silent Hill, including the video games and film adaptation. Well, there we have it. Do you guys agree with our list? Were there any movies that we missed? Leave us all your thoughts and feelings in the comments down below, and perhaps we can do a part 2. Before I go though, I just want to respond to a few comments from one of our last videos, Top 5 Scary Japanese Vampire Horror Movies. Bubbles Artwork said, "Anything about vampires interests me. More scary vampire stories, please." Well, as long as it's not Scary Japanese Vampire Horror Movies Part 2, because there are literally 5 movies that exist in that category. So, I'd love to talk more about vampire movies, because I love them. And as you know, one of our editors kept that my love for Twilight in the final cut, and I will never forgive them for it. Jen. She told me as well, she slacked me, she was like, "You told me to cut it, but I'm keeping it in, the world needs to know." It's like the shade. AMB said, "A vampire movie that doesn't have bite is just terrible, both the movie and the pun. I love it. I respect that pun. That was very good." And it's true, a vampire movie that doesn't have bite, it's like, what's the point of watching it? I'm all about Vampire Diaries right now. And it's got a lot of bite. A lot of bite and a lot of sex, you know? Best combination. David Eddy said, "Any scary video with Lucy's narration would be the greatest thing in the world. I need more videos of our beloved queen. All hail Lucy." Well, your standards are pretty low. So, I think there's a lot of good things in the world that may come before my videos, but thank you, I appreciate it. Oh, yeah, you need to see more videos, so I think you should head over to our brand new channel, Top 10 Central Dark. We are launching today. Today. We're launching today, but you'll see this video later. So by the time you see this, we will have already launched.
I don't know. I don't trust.
What is he looking at?
What is
that? I've never been more scared of a squirrel in my life.
It feels like my heart's gonna explode.
I'm going to be appearing less frequently on this channel. I'll still be here, so don't worry, but I'll be mostly on Central Dark. So if you want to see me, come join me. Come join me over there. Sally Cannell said, "Shout out for Lost Girl. Damn how I missed that show. Give me sexy succubus now, please. Thank you." Right? I feel like I blew everyone's minds by reminding them that Lost Girl existed. Lost Girl is the best. We all need to watch it. Let's all watch it again together, okay? No one, just me. Nicholas Kaufman said, "Shout out to all fans of Lost Girls." See, Nicholas wants it as well. It'll just be the three of us watching it together. Clay Schutz said, "I love it when you play with your hair. Lol, you are still the funniest host on responses." I mean, I have to touch my hair because it's long. Like, it gets in my face. I have to move it, but you're starting to sound like Jerry, and anyone that follows me knows about Jerry. Jerry really likes my hair, and it's a bit too much. He started asking my sisters about their hair. Bit weird, but okay. And on that note, if you haven't already, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you never miss another scary vid. Until next time, I'll see you later. It was actually Jacob's Ladder that inspired the horror franchise Silent Hill. It was actually Jacob's Ladder that inspired the horror franchise Silent Hill, including the video game. It's the last line, just get it out.